Are the polls real? Will the reset take? For more on the state of this topsy-turvy political year, we turn to Politics Monday. That's Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report and Tamara Keith of NPR. Welcome back, ladies. Tamara, tell me about this Trump speech today. Was this the reset, the pivot we keep talking about?
Or was the last one the pivot? Or was the last one before that the pivot? I think Hillary Clinton has said this. There is only one Donald Trump. There are different flavors of Donald Trump. There's teleprompter speech, policy speech, Donald Trump, which is what we got today. There is rally Donald Trump, where he says stuff and gets the crowd going. And then there's Twitter Donald Trump at various hours of the day. So this is part, you know, about once every month we get one of these teleprompter speeches. In some ways, this was a reset. His tax plan that you mentioned in the piece, it was on his website until about 24 hours ago. Then it came down. Now there's a new tax plan, which aligns with a tax plan from House Republicans, moves him more into the orbit of the Republican mainstream. And there were several things in this speech that moved him a little bit closer to the Republican mainstream.
And I think that's the key, because, you know, if you look at the biggest challenge for Donald Trump right now, he's doing very well among these white working class voters. We keep talking about that. Where he's not doing well are white-collar voters. And this was a message directly related to them. It was interesting to see Hillary Clinton talk about repackaging Reaganomics. Well, for a lot of those voters who right now are saying either I'm voting for Hillary Clinton or I'm undecided on Donald Trump, they kind of like the Reaganomics message. They like the tax cut message. They like the lack of regulation or, you know, scaling back on regulation message. And it's the economy is one of the 14 different areas that the Wall Street Journal poll asked, who do you think does a better job of? Question, Donald Trump only was ahead on four of those. One of those was the economy. So this is a place where if I were that campaign, I would be spending much more time talking about the economy, a lot less time beating up on your fellow Republicans.
And of course, we're going to hear more from Hillary Clinton on this subject later, or as the week goes on, apparently every day. So let's talk about last week's unforced, or were they unforced, errors. The errors, the series of errors. Is that what led us to today, to the teleprompter speech?
It certainly would seem like he needed a reset. He needed to have a clean break from last week's sort of rolling errors. But even as late as yesterday, he was tweeting fact checks about the baby. The baby being a baby that...
The crying baby that
there was
he
a
made
crying
the joke
baby,
about.
And then he made a joke, and it was interpreted as him kicking a baby out of a rally when maybe the baby had already left. But as yesterday, he was tweeting about this. So today's speech, the challenge is we are getting closer and closer to the general election. And in today's speech, he said, I will have more specifics. I will have details on my website. Tune in a couple of weeks. We've heard that before. I wait for
you
digging
wait
into policy, but maybe this race isn't really about policy.
Well, that's part of the question. But on the other hand, let's just measure this by, just for giggles, by conventional measures. Hillary Clinton, including during the Olympics, is hammering him with anti-Trump ads.
Right.
Not a peep in conventional sense coming from Donald Trump.
Right. He still has yet to show us that he's going to run a traditional campaign. Now, look, he's gotten this far.
Not one television ad.
He doesn't have a traditional anything,
right?
And he's gotten this far. And so this is what we've been going back and forth about for this entire campaign, which is he's either going to show us at the end of the day that he's upended all the rules of politics, that you don't need these fancy consultants, you don't need ads, you don't need polls, you don't need any of it, just your personality and your message and the environment alone can drive voters to the polls.
But let me try something with
yes,
you.
Yes, please.
When we were sitting at the conventions and we heard him say, I am your voice, I think we all agreed that that was his message, that he had settled on a message. We have not heard that since.
Well, I think still to the voters that support him, that still is the message, that he is going to be the person that stands up for us. Mm-hmm. His challenge is that he hasn't broadened it beyond that same group of voters he was speaking to at the convention. And this speech, for the first time, what he did was he married the traditional sort of Chamber of Commerce, Republican message on taxes and entitlements with the populist anti-NAFTA, anti-trade message that he's been saying on the trail, trying to bring the party together. Again, unifying the party has been a challenge that he continues to struggle with. Yeah. And until he figures that out, Hillary Clinton's going to continue to have a lead.
Well, and also for the first time, we've seen kind of both candidates talking about mental stability as an issue speaking about their opponent.
Yeah, Hillary Clinton's campaign has begun this several months, or at least a month ago, I would say, talking about whether he's temperamentally fit to be president. At the convention, Michael Bloomberg said, let's choose a sane candidate. And that was a big moment. Here is a major figure at a convention talking about sanity. Donald Trump this week seems to have gone to the I know you are, but what am I school. And now he's saying that Hillary Clinton is temperamentally unfit.
Based on her comment saying that she had a short-circuited an answer.
Yeah, she short-circuited an answer. This has also spawned some conspiracy theories about her health.
So let's talk about someone else getting into the race. Someone probably, I think it's fair to say, the three of us have never heard of, a gentleman by the name of Evan McMullen, who says he's going to represent all the Republicans who are not for Trump.
Right. So
who is he?
He's a former CIA operative. He's a former House staffer who's now is retired from his position at the House. You know, this is what we've been talking about, I feel like, at this table for so long. You have this group of Republicans who say they can't support Trump, but they can't find somebody else to rally around. Here's his challenge, getting on ballots in many states. The deadlines have closed.
The same time the last time we talked about David French.
Remember that?
Running.
David French, his challenge, getting on ballots. This is a candidate who also went to BYU, the thought being he could play well in a place like Utah or Arizona that has a big Mormon population. Arizona, you have to get a lot of signatures to get on the ballot, and the deadline there is the first week in September. Utah, not as arduous, but that means just like one or two states that he may have an impact on. And quite frankly, if we're talking about Arizona and Utah in September and October, this race is a blowout. Like, it's not even going to be close. We might as well just sleep in on election day.
Well, except it doesn't seem at all to be the case. At least no one's
willing
to quite go that far. So the Friday night, late night, programmed against the Olympics endorsement of Paul Ryan, Kelly Ayotte, and John McCain. Does that help them at all, or does it hurt them?
No, and it really looked like those endorsements came under duress. he was reading. He looked uncomfortable saying it. No, it doesn't help them.
If I were Senator Kelly Ayotte, who right now is looking at a very, very tough race in a state that is now turning away from Donald Trump, I'd be like, you know what, thanks, but that's okay. You can keep your endorsement.
Obviously. And I think that's kind of what Paul Ryan said, which was that's nice.
That's nice, but I don't.
You don't think it necessarily helps. You don't think it necessarily helps.
No, they're in a tough spot. I mean, all of these people who are down ballot are in a tough spot because they've already on some level associated themselves with the person at the top of the ticket. And at the same time, they are trying to distance themselves. And Democrats aren't going to let them get away with distancing themselves
And brace for whatever may happen this week as opposed to last week.
Yes,
Tamara Keith of NPR, Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report. Thank you both very much.
You're welcome.